Alien civilizations, the Kardashev scale, and the Dyson sphere. Let's try to think about how far humanity has progressed in its 200,000 years of existence, and especially in the last 150. Well, our galaxy, approximately, is 10 billion years old. In about 200,000 years, we have gone from being hominids hiding in caves to a society that uses the internet, explores space, and builds robots. With a huge acceleration in the last 150 years, where could an alien race born, say, 6 billion years ago have come? That's a long time, during which time an alien civilization might have developed sophisticated propulsion, systems perhaps faster than light, wormhole technology, or some other kind of cosmic shortcut that would allow them to colonize the galaxy and beyond. Based on this consideration, one might ask, is there any way to classify the technological level achieved by any civilization, including ours? Well, in an article of 1963 entitled Transmission of Information by Extraterrestrial Civilizations, the Russian astronomer Nikolai S. Kardashev proposed a system to classify any extraterrestrial civilization based on the energy available to them to be able to make radio transmissions beyond the boundaries of their planet of origin. This system took the name of Kardashev's scale. Kardashev's motivation for coming up with the scale was that if we can understand how advanced civilizations source their energy, we can look for clues that they are harvesting or using it in our observations of stars and galaxies. In fact, his scale provides a crude way of quantifying the detectability of a technological civilization. Type 3 civilizations would hypothetically have a huge impact on their host galaxies and be clearly identifiable due to their interactions with galactic objects such as stars and black holes. More speculatively, the transportation and communication mechanisms such a civilization might use between these bodies could also be detectable. Over the years, this scale abandoned the reference to radio transmissions to refer more generally to the degree of energy that a given civilization was able to use for any purpose. The Russian astronomer devised this classification system because he noticed that the level of energy consumption on Earth had been increasing steadily for centuries. This scale originally included 3 stages, each with its own characteristic energy level, depending on the source of the energy used. Let's try to find out how this works. The first type, Kardashev 1, is reached when a civilization manages to exploit all the energy potential present on its planet of origin. If we take the Earth as an example, considering that almost all the energy available on our planet is represented by the incident solar radiation, equal to 1.73 times 10 to the 17th watt per year, while other energy sources such as geothermal, 3.2 times 10 to the 13 watts, or tidal, 3 times 10 to the 12 watts, are, in comparison, negligible. It is clear why humanity is still very far from falling into this category of civilization. In fact, the world's energy consumption in the year 2019 was 1.75 times 10 to the 13 watts, which is only 1/10,000th of the total energy received from the sun. And as of now, there is no known way for human civilization to use the equivalent of the total solar energy absorbed by the Earth without completely covering the surface with man-made structures, which is not feasible with current technology. However, a civilization with this capability, among many other things it could do, would be able, for example, to completely control its planetary biosphere, modifying its climate at will. At the second level of the scale, Kardashev 2 type are those civilizations that are able to capture all the energy produced by the star of their solar system. And for the entirely, we mean all the energy produced and radiated by the star, and not only the energy that arrives on the planet where the civilization resides. To make a comparison, the energy radiated from the sun is equal to almost 4 times 10 to the 26 watts, an amount of energy a billion times higher than that which actually arrives on Earth. Being able to harness this energy could ensure an entire civilization the ability to survive virtually every known natural disaster. Only the extinction of the star or the destruction of the entire solar system could bring such a super civilization to its knees. Once a Type 2 civilization will have been able to harness all the power of its star, very likely it may want to extend its borders beyond the native solar system, pushing up to more and more distant stars. In this scenario, we begin to find the first physical limits, since, as far as we know, it is impossible to travel or communicate with speeds greater than, but also equal to, those of light. Traveling from one solar system to another, therefore, would be extremely difficult and costly in terms of time and resources. However, imagining that a highly evolved civilization has managed to find a way to overcome the relativistic limits known to us in a short time would be able to become a civilization of type Kardashev 3, able to colonize and then exploit the energy of its entire galaxy. A super civilization of this level of technology, with the beauty of over 10 to the 37 watts of energy, would probably be able to survive every imaginable cataclysm, from close explosions of supernovae to the rapid expansion of the black hole at the center of their galaxy. The Kardashev scale, as originally conceived by its author, would end with the third type, but this has not prevented astronomers and physicists, as well as science fiction authors, to conceive even higher degrees, bringing to the extreme consequences the principle of energy exploitation. At a hypothetical degree, Kardashev 4, for example, we will find a civilization able to exploit the energy produced by an entire clusters of galaxies, while at the degree Kardashev 5, even all the matter and energy within its own observable universe, and probably travel beyond it. But already, a civilization of type 3 would be for us so advanced to escape any attempt to predict how it would really be or what it would be able to do. And so there is probably not much point in worrying about type 4 or 5 or 6. And where do we Earthlings stand? Well, nothing prevents us to assume the existence of a civilization of type 0. That is, the one to which belongs all civilizations able to use at least 10 to the 6 watt of energy. The members of a type 0 civilization, as we can imagine, would be able to exploit only a small part of the energy arriving on their home planet. They would then be limited to exploiting the energy coming from raw materials. They would not yet have the ability to leave their home planet, but they would be trying. Yes, you guessed it right. We are talking about us humans. And for the record, it seems that our current score, according to the astronomer Carl Sagan, who has devised a logarithmic formula capable of calculating even the decimal of intermediate levels of the scale, is 0.7. In short, our current civilization would be a Kardashev 0.7. Extrapolating on the basis of the known current growth rate of our planetary energy consumption, according to Michio Kaku, U.S. theoretical physicist, our species could reach the Kardashev 1 level around the year 2200, Kardashev 2 around 5200, and Kardashev 3 around 7800. Evaluations perhaps a little optimistic, at least as regards the timing for the achievement of the last two levels. What do you think? Do you have any idea about it? There is still another question hanging in the air. What would a society much more advanced than ours have to do to be able to fully exploit the energy of their star? And here comes into play the concept of Dyson sphere, proposed by the English physicist and mathematician Freeman Dyson in an article of 1960. In practice, Dyson believed it possible that a civilization sufficiently evolved, and therefore in need of a growing supply of energy, could use the planetary material available to build around the star a kind of shell capable of capturing all its radiation. Although such megastructures are theoretically possible, the construction of a stable Dyson sphere is currently beyond our engineering capabilities. In fictional accounts, the concept of a Dyson sphere is often interpreted as an artificial hollow sphere of matter around a star, but in reality, Dyson realized that a solid shell or ring built around the star would be gravitationally unstable, kind of like Saturn's rings, which, if they were solid, would eventually become off-center and crash into the planet. The structure that Dyson imagined consisted instead of a swarm of objects that travel on independent orbits around the star, just as the individual blocks of ice and rock orbit independently around Saturn. Not a Dyson sphere, then, but a Dyson swarm. The purpose with which Dyson theorized the existence of such structures is the same as Nikolai S. Kardashev, to simplify the search for alien civilizations, trying to hypothesize how they might appear to an external observer and the signals they could send. But how to find out if they really exist? What signs would a sphere of Dyson, located several light years away from us, leak to the outside world? Its distinctive mark, wrote Dyson, would be the infrared radiation, in particular the one at 10 micrometers. The light captured by the sphere would in fact heat the internal surface, and the heat would be observable outside as an excess of emissions in the infrared. The target of an eventual search would therefore be stars with a surplus of infrared and with significant variations in brightness due to the non-compact structure of the Dyson swarm, or to its still partial construction. And to tell the truth, stars with strange brightness variations are certainly not lacking in recent years. In particular, in 2015, you all remember how the web literally went crazy with the news that the Kepler Space Telescope had detected an anomaly in the emission of the star KIC 8462852, a spectral F object 1,484 light-years away in the constellation Swan. Also called Tabby Star, named after Tabitha Boyajian, the U.S. astronomer who carried out the first studies of the star in 2011, KIC 8462852, is subject to periodic and intense changes in brightness, to which you cannot explain, even assuming the existence of a planet in transit. Usually, in fact, when a planet passes in front of its star, the reduction in brightness does not exceed 1%, and this only in the presence of very large planets, the size of Jupiter, for example. The hypotheses advanced to explain the phenomenon have been, in time, numerous. It has been talked about fragments of comets, a planet that is about to be swallowed by the star, a planet with rings similar to Saturn, a planet that has disintegrated or asteroid swarms. More recently, some researchers have hypothesized the existence of a dust cloud of irregular shape that rotates around the star, and this, at the moment, is perhaps the best explanation we have. Among the first hypotheses advanced was that made a lot of discussions and immediately captured the imagination of many. The existence of a mega-alien structure that partially surrounds the star. Around that distant star, there would be an incredible artifact made by a civilization of level Kardashev 2, a kind of Dyson sphere, to harness all the energy of the star and use it for their purposes, whatever they are. Hypothesis that the same theoretical physicist Michio Kaku seems to be inclined to share. Tabby seems to have a mass of about 1.43 times that of our sun and a diameter of slightly more. The alien structure should therefore contain an object of that size. According to David Kipping of Columbia University, the structure should still be at a certain distance from the star, both not to be destroyed and to justify just those variations of brightness detected by our instruments. So on balance, it turns out that the diameter of the Dyson sphere should be at least 5 times that of the star. In addition, since the variation of brightness is large and irregular, we must imagine that this megastructure is made by a swarm of small bodies arranged to form the sphere, or at least by a number of large bodies, just like the swarm of Dyson we talked about a little while ago. A sort of huge spherical puzzle made of thousands of probes with dimensions similar to those of a small asteroid. But if the Dyson sphere really existed, what should we expect to see that confirms its existence? As we said earlier, we should observe a very noticeable infrared radiation. Well, this excess of infrared radiation, at the moment, has not yet been identified. Moral, for now, we have to be satisfied to give the phenomenon a natural explanation and postpone to other occasions the possibility to meet the Kardashev civilizations, with all the frightening that their superhuman indifference could instill in the soul of us Earthlings. Still much closer to the caves than to the stars.